Yesterday, USA, for the good times, for the good times, for the good times. This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
Howl, howl, howl! Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Well, hello there, Fred Foy, and thank you, everybody. Thank you for tuning in once again to The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio Superstation, the station founded by your friend, my friend, the man with a million friends, Mr. Bill Bragg. And hope you are doing good, my friend Bill, out there in Richardson, Texas. No family reunion this year, I guess, so we're not going to get to see you. But, well, you know, maybe we'll sneak out there and get to see you somehow, or maybe have you out here to visit us here in beautiful northwestern Michigan, Traverse City, see the bay and go for a balloon ride or a boat ride or a fishing trip or whatever you want to do. There's a lot of stuff to see and do around this area. Anyway, so much though, we were actually thinking of having the family reunion here, and that's still not out of the question, maybe not for this year, but in upcoming reunions, we may host it here. Who knows? But,
B-A-B-E-B-B-I-Biggie-Bye-B.
Oh, shut up.
Oh. You said about the bay. It reminded me of the bay.
Bay rum. Yeah. Well, now the glow girl is singing back here in the corner now. Just call her Otis, all right? I know, she doesn't look like an elevator. But anyway... Let's stop right there.
She
anyway,
sure lifts.
Let's move on here.
She lifts your spirits, I'm sure of that. Otherwise, you wouldn't be marrying her. So.
Yeah. Well, you had an interesting day or two up here so far.
Yeah.
Sitting in master control with me at the TV station, getting bored.
Golf.
Watching hours and hours of golf and basketball. And
what was on yesterday? That was really interesting. What was on yesterday?
Golf.
Golf. Yeah, yeah, it's flogged backwards, right?
Flogged
I feel like
backwards.
I've been flogged.
Yeah, not on this show, you're not, fella. Anyway.
You didn't introduce me.
The annoying voice you've been hearing, folks, is Steve Archiver Panic.
No, that was your fiance. Oh.
Oh. Hon, would you like to be my new co-host?
We'll stare you heard Steve, her voice.
We'll
we did hear it, didn't
Steve
we?
Out in the dumper, man. We, they'll never find him.
We did hear her voice, didn't we?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Hello, you all hear my voice?
Yes.
The glow girl.
The glow girl.
Yeah. I like that. The glow girl.
The glow girl. Otherwise, Steve would have to dress up in drag.
That would be a drag.
That would, yes. And an insult to most women. But anyway. All right, folks, we've got an action-packed program for you here today. We have an episode of Mandrake the Magician to bring to you.
Ooh, magical.
And we have an episode of pull out the index card, Johnny. We have another one of those days. We have an episode of the Gulf Screen Guild, Parents by Proxy, starring Jack Benny and Paulette Goddard. And we'll tell you a little bit more about that
Jack
program.
Jack Benny, huh?
Right, right.
You Stephen, just love him. You put him in everything you possibly can squeeze in.
Yes.
Well, every denomination.
We stated from the very beginning that Jack Benny was an all-time favorite. And even Frank Brzee, when we interviewed him, say, oh, he's wonderful. I hope you play a lot of them. So we're going to. Hear that, Frank? We're going to play more Jack Benny.
Hear that, and, Jack? We're going to play more of you, too.
Okay. Yes. Thank you, our audience of one. Anyway, and that's all together, not just here in the studio. Right? Anyway, if you would be so kind, sir, as to reach over to our good friend, the McGee Machine, who
we haven't used in a while. Yeah, we haven't used that in a while here.
Yeah, we had the interview. We had the Jack Benny roast and all that. What? You hit him in there today, huh? All right. Well, that's fine. That's fine. And there's our familiar McGee Machine static warming up there. So sit back, close. Oh, my God. Sit back, folks. Close your eyes. And remember Mandrake the Magician, and we'll be back.
Presenting Mandrake the Magician. Closing a chapter of exciting adventure in which an enemy submarine that had been destroying United States shipping is sunk, Mandrake finds himself in possession of a small red Morocco book, a vital clue to widespread sabotage. Now, with Lothar at the wheel of the dead gangster Barracuda's car, Mandrake and Tommy Turk are headed from the scene of their recent adventures toward the small town just a few miles inland.
Where you want Lothar drive first when reach town, Master?
The hotel, Lothar. Nada will have arrived ahead of us in the plane. I'll notify the sheriff first to pick up Dorfman's body at Shore Point. And then we'll hold a council of war on our next move.
What next move be, Master?
Well, we'll get the jump on our enemies if possible. At least we know one of them by name. High Pitch. The fellow Nada saw looking in the window back at the shack.
Too bad, Lothar, not catch him. Him get away in dark.
Yes. And I'm wondering where he went. He's payoff man for the big boss, remember? No, he didn't walk out from town.
Got a car, maybe?
I think so. But if he did drive out, he's still behind us. This is the only road from the point into town.
Well, suppose we pull up alongside road. Wait for him to pass us. Then chase him.
No, that's not such a good plan, Lothar. Better to have all cars coming from the point stopped by the police. We can't afford to let High Pitch slip through our fingers. Besides, there's one element of danger, Lothar. You understand?
Danger? Sure, Lothar, understand.
I haven't got anybody but my grandmother. She hasn't seen me since I was a baby. Doesn't make any difference what happens to me.
Why, Tommy, you haven't said a word since we left the point. What made you say that?
Because I saw you in the mirror. You nodded toward me.
Oh.
You'd lay for this fella, High Pitch, but you're afraid I'd get hurt.
Well, I'm afraid you are a little young for this sort of thing, Tommy. You see, it's our duty, Lothar's and mine, to deliver you safely to that grandmother you just mentioned. Understand?
Sure. I'm anxious to get back to town, too, but not because I'm afraid.
Oh, we know Tommy not afraid of anything.
No.
I used to get scared. You see, I was on the other side when the war started. Mother died from shock after an air raid, Dad started flying planes across the Atlantic. He just disappeared. So I came home on a ship with a lot of other kids. Me and Trix, my dog. See, I was on my way to join Grandmother with Trix when the ship was blown up. You know, that one we were all on together.
Yes. Yes, I know, Tommy.
You see, Trix and I were real pals. She's an air raid orphan, too. She had six brothers and sisters. But when the air raid siren started blowing, I just grabbed her up and...
Yes, Tommy. Go ahead.
Well, after the all-clear siren, I went back and... Trix and I were both orphans.
Watch it, Lothar. Nearly went into the ditch.
Sorry, Master. Lothar got something in the eye. Can't see for a minute.
Oh.
Take my handkerchief, Lothar. Your eyes...
Thanks, Tommy.
Mr. Mandrake.
Yes, Tommy?
Mr. Mandrake, you won't send me to Grandmother's until I've had a chance to look for Trix. She might have been saved, and she won't take anything to eat from anybody but me. I gotta try to find her.
We won't leave a stone unturned in our efforts to find Trix, Tommy. And I'll take the responsibility of squaring you with Grandmother.
Oh, gosh, that's swell. I was afraid when I got to town, Grandmother might be there and wouldn't understand about Trix.
Car behind us, Lothar. Hear that motor?
Lothar here, Master.
I can't see any headlights behind us.
You will when she rounds that bend we just passed.
There she is now.
Ah, a heavy van. She's got lights strung all over her.
Lothar, try to keep ahead of her, Master?
No, I don't think you can in this old jalopy.
Say, that fellow's coming as though he was going someplace.
That's an empty van from the way she's swaying.
Gosh, look at that fella come. We'll never catch him after he passes us.
I'm not so sure he intends to pass us.
You think he'll stop, Master?
At that speed, no. Slow down, Lothar. Give him plenty of room.
Yes, Master.
He's not slowing down.
Open your car door, Lothar.
Yes, Master.
Open the door on your side, Tommy.
Yes, sir.
Him right on our tail, Master.
He's coming right at us.
I thought I knew what he was after. He's going to drive right through us. Jump, Tommy. Jump, Lothar.
Who's there?
High pitch. Open up, Slate.
1 minute. Come in, high pitch.
Right.
Now, what in blazes did you come here for?
Oh, I see you're packing.
Of course I'm packing. I'm leaving.
Yeah?
Thought you were on your way out of here with your truck.
My truck's in the garage. I got a bad dent in the front fender. I hit something.
Want me to report your reckless driving to the chief?
Who said I was reckless? I hit it on purpose.
Look here, high pitch. I haven't got time to waste on you. I'm...
Unpack. You're not leaving, Slade.
I'm not taking orders from you either.
Okay. It's your funeral. You never would listen.
Wait a minute.
Well?
If you've got anything on your mind, spill it. You know I've got a report to the chief.
What are you going to report?
Shore Point blown up. Submarine base destroyed. 5 enemies of the great plan eliminated.
I think I just eliminated 3 of the enemies of the great plan with my truck. The other 2, Nader and her brother Sigrid, are here in the hotel.
What are you talking about? Heard the explosion when Shore Point was blown up.
You heard the submarine blow up. That bombing plane that was headed for you know where. Heard it, too. She passed flying low without lights.
You're joking.
Yeah? Swell joke on Captain X, Alex Jefferson, and the crew of the sub. They went up like they was tied to a skyrocket. 1'll get you 10, they ain't come down yet.
Killed?
What do you think?
You know how it happened?
Sure. Double-crossed by the pilot, Dorfman. He went patriotic before he kicked off.
Oh, now, please.
Yeah, I heard the whole thing. Nearly got caught looking in the window of Barracuda's shack.
How did you happen to be there?
I dropped my load for the sub at the point and was heading back to town with an empty van. Had engine trouble. I was only about a quarter of a mile from the point when I heard the explosion.
You went back?
Sure I went back. I was curious. I knew that explosion came from out at sea.
Well?
I learned all I could and I got back to my truck. Waited for Mandrake, Lothar, and that kid to pass me. Followed them and blasted them off the road.
Good work, I bet. Did you stop to make sure that the...
I'm a hit-and-run driver. The lights went on in a house right alongside the road when I smacked their car. I beat it.
And you can't be sure
that... I'm sure I made kindling wood out of that jalopy, and they was in it.
Well, could be worse.
Yeah, it could. And you better get to that flossy nodder and find out just how much worse and spike it.
What do you mean?
I mean Mandrake's got one of the little red books.
He's got the... What?
Yeah, with names, dates, a map, and everything. A smart guy might do something with that.
We've got to get that book back, Hypich.
Yeah. I thought you'd get the idea. Nada's room number is 47.
47, eh? Room 47, please.
You think she'll come here?
Your crude methods can't be used in a case like this, Hypich.
My crude methods worked once tonight. But I'm willing to watch you, mastermind, and learn.
Hello, is that you, Mandrake?
No, Miss Nada. I'm afraid Mandrake has met with an accident.
Accident? You mean he's been hurt?
Now, don't be alarmed. Could I speak to you at once, privately?
Why, I don't know who you are.
My name's Slade.
Slade? I know no one by that name.
Well, confidentially, I belong to the Army Intelligence Division.
Oh, I see.
Now, it's vitally important that I obtain all the facts and evidence in your possession pertaining to certain happenings tonight. Turn over at once to my superiors. You understand?
Yes, of course.
We're particularly interested in a little red book.
Oh, I have it. Mandrake gave it to me for safekeeping.
Oh, splendid. Now, with your permission...
Please come to number 47 at once.
Mandrake, Lothar, and Tommy been seriously injured? Will Narda fall into the trap being prepared for her? Be sure to listen next Wednesday at the same time to Mandrake the Magician. Mandrake the Magician is adapted from the King Features adventure strip of the same name.
Hi, this is Frank Brzee, Little Beaver on Old Time Radio's Red Rider. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts Big John and Steve, heard exclusively on Yesterday USA Radio.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brzee, and welcome back, everybody. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Mandrake the Magician. Yes, that was a continuing serial, as were most of the juvenile shows of that ilk. However, we only have two episodes of that particular run, so it made no sense to... sometimes it doesn't make any sense to play these, but then again, it does, because it gives you an example of what the show was like. We're considering playing another continuing, like maybe like a 12-chapter serial like we did with the Buck Rogers and the Dick Tracys in episodes past.
Does it stay crunchy in milk?
If you would like to hear another continuing serial begin here on The Glowing Dial, write to us and let us know. And We'll tell you how to do that just a little bit later. Right now, Steve is going to give us a little bit of history on Mandrake, which we forgot to do just before we started the episode there.
We all know Mandrake the Magician is a comic strip in the funny papers. It was done through King Features by Lee Falk. And I remember reading in the newspaper just a month ago, Lee Falk passed away. He also did The Phantom. Also, that was another one of his comic strips that they did, too. Okay, radio program we just listened to, Paul Dukas was the classical artist for the theme on it, and that was also in The Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yes, Mickey Mouse. Fantasia.
It was organized a bit here, you know, on the organ. Organized, yes.
Oh,
uh-huh.
God.
Okay, the broadcast...
Peddle your joke somewhere else.
Broadcast history of Mandrake, it ran from 1940 to 1942 on the Mutual Network, 15 minutes long, 3 days a week. The cast consists of Raymond Edward Johnson as Mandrake, very famous man.
Oh, yes.
Mandrake is a mystic educated in Tibet by a master of magic, and his companion was his servant Lothar, who was a giant who could rip a crocodile's jaws apart or break the back of an anthropoid ape.
Well, quite job specifications there, huh?
Yes. Mandrake and his servant lived in a house of mystery and many secrets, and his chant, the Invoco Legem Magicarum, invoked the laws of magic and set into play his bag of tricks.
What was that invocation?
It was Invoco Legem Magicarum.
Well, same to you, fella. Anyway, in our next program, folks, we're going to get right into it here, is an episode of the Gulf Screen Guild. And this one is starring Jack Benny and Paulette Goddard in Parents by Proxy. And this is from March 29, 1942. And Steve has a little bit of information on that series as well.
All right. We've already played a Screen Guild program earlier earlier in one of our Glowing Dials, but it was the Lady Esther Screen Guild. This one is the Gulf Screen Guild, which is the original version of the program. Ran from 1939 to 42. And as we record this, the last recording of the Screen Guild by Gulf occurred on this date, April the 19th, back in 1942.
Well, cool.
Weird.
So, is there anything else you have in the series there that you want to do?
Oh, there was just various sponsors of the program throughout the year, you know, Lady Esther and Camel and, you know, various.
So, this is one of the last Gulf sponsored programs.
Yes, this one here was March of 42 is one of the final programs.
Okay, I guess without any further ado, let's reach for the McGee machine and get this thing going here. And, all right.
Okay, I'm done.
There you go.
Yeah.
Cool, there you go. All right, so, folks, close your eyes, sit back, and remember the Gulf Screen Guild. Parents by Proxy, starring Jack Benny and Paulette Goddard, from March 29, 1942.
The Gulf Screen Guild Theater. Starring Paulette Goddard and Jack Benny in Parrot. And now here is your host, the director of the Star's own theater, Roger Pryor.
Good evening, everyone. Tonight, the Gulf Oil Company and your neighborhood good Gulf dealer bring you radio's number one comedian, Jack Benny. And with him, one of movie-dom's most glamorous stars, Paulette Goddard, in a hilarious comedy, Parent by Proxy. In just a moment, our play will begin. But meanwhile, we'd like to say,
friends, these days, most of us feel that even a car that's apparently running in tip-top shape rates extra attention just to be sure that no little routine protection has been neglected. Well, when you get to wondering about that, why not take your car to a man whose business it is to know about such things, to your good Gulf dealer? He'll help you save your car with his Gulflex Car Saver Services that assures you of planned car-saving service by men who know how to do the job and who have the specialized equipment necessary. That way, you get a combination of a number of seasonal car saver services. Some of these car saver services are draining and flushing your crankcase and refilling with the proper seasonal Gulf motor oil, changing to summer gear lubricant, a complete Gulflex lubrication job, cleaning your air filter, cross-switching your tires, plus traditional Gulf courtesy services. So when you get your good Gulf dealer's car saver services, you're sure to get done many of those jobs which are vitally important and which are so easy to forget. Stop at your neighborhood good Gulf dealer's tomorrow and start to care for your car for your country.
Oscar Bradley's music raises the curtain on Parent by Proxy, starring Jack Benny and Paulette Goddard. As our story opens, Jim Sloan, alias Jack Benny, who is a big splash in the American plumbing business, has just strolled into his office and taken his place at his desk.
Ah, good morning, Miss Humphrey.
Good morning, Mr. Sloan. You're in early today.
Well, a businessman has to be on his toes, Miss Humphrey. I expect it to be a busy day, a very busy day. In fact, I hardly know what to do first. What time is it now?
12:30, sir.
Oh. Then in that case, open these files under L.
Under L?
Yes, my lunch is in there. And, by the way, is there a copy of the Morning Times around?
On your desk, Mr. Sloan.
Good, good. There's a little item I'd like to show you, Miss Humphrey. Your boss attended the charity ball last night.
No.
Oh, yes. Society is opening its doors to Jane Sloan. Even if I did make my money in plumbing pictures. Ah, here's the story right on the front page. I'll show you my name. Among those present were Biddle, Bowles, Terry, Fletcher, Morrow, Gray. Continued on page 12. Sharon, Burns, Riley, Jackson, Beloyne, Goldblatt. Continued on page 33. Can't seem to find the rest of the list.
Oh, there it is, Mr. Sloan. Next to the obituary column.
Oh, yes, yes. I'm glad it wasn't under it. Larson, O'Neill, Hickey. Aha! Harry Baldwin, James Sloan, and Austin Peterson. Poor old Austin. Imagine being last on the list. I'll bet he feels like a nobody.
I'll bet he does.
It was really a gala evening, Miss Humphrey, and there I was in the middle of it, drinking and dancing. Of course, I would have looked better if I'd had a partner. And, oh, yes, I took a chance on a raffle.
What kind of a raffle?
Oh, I don't know. I never win anyway, but Miss Palmer said it was a thing to do.
Miss Palmer, huh?
Oh, don't use that tone of voice, Miss Humphrey. Clara Palmer is a lovely girl. Of course, her hair is a little stringy. That's what gave me the idea for my new grizzle shower. Now, run along to our office and call the Edgemere Stables. I want to find out how much a pono poly costs.
A what?
A pono poly. I mean a poly pono. A polo pony. You know, one of those things you sit on when you play pono. I mean poly. A polo. I'd have been better off if I'd taken up badminton. Or tennis. Now, call the stables. Clara told me if I want to become socially prominent, I should take up the game.
But, Mr. Sloan, you fall out of a swivel chair. How will you stay on a horse?
I'll hang a guitar around my neck, and he'll think I'm Gene Autry. I can go along with a quip. Now, get out.
Yes, sir. Jim, darling.
Oh, hello, Clara.
Jim, dear, I have the most fabulously wonderful news for you. You won the charity raffle.
I did? How much?
Oh, but the prize wasn't money.
Oh.
But, darling, it was something money can't even buy.
Razor blade?
Oh, no, no, silly. You won the privilege of adopting a refugee orphan.
I did. I mean,
I did. Yes, yes. Now, the child's name is Marcel Bender. Isn't it too utterly thrilling?
Oh, it's the utterliest thing I've ever heard of. But look, I can't take an orphan.
Now, it arrives today, homeless and hungry. And if you don't take it, your social prestige may suffer.
It will, eh? Well, where's the kid from?
France. Oh, you do speak French, don't you?
Oh, not fluently. I know a couple of words.
Oh, good. Well, let me know what you decide, dear boy. Bonjour.
What is that?
I said bonjour.
Oh, French. French. Well, the two words I happen to know are oui, oui. You know? see you later. Marcel, huh? Cute name for a kid. See, no home, hungry, nobody to love him. Gee, I could be both a father and a mother to him. And then if he couldn't get along with his father, he could always come to the mother in me. It's a wonderful feeling at that, you know.
Oh, Mr. Sloan, you can get a polo pony for $3,000.
Poor little thing. I think I'll have him sleep in the same bed with me.
Sleep in the same bed with
me? Probably hasn't had anything to eat for days.
Not even oats?
Oh, what he needs is hot soup and lollipops and a warm bunny suit to sleep in.
Bunny suit?
Miss Humphrey, will you do me a favor?
Oh, what is it, Mr. Sloan?
Will you pin those little three-cornered pants on him? Now, what else do I need? Oh, yes, I want to look at a crib, please.
Yes, sir, for a little boy.
What difference does it make? Do little girls sleep side saddle?
No, sir. Now, here's a very popular model. We call it our teepee-tot beddy. Isn't it a tootie-wootie? Just the same for a itty-kitty-witty.
Uh-huh. How much is it?
Only $18.50.
Oh. Anything off for cashy-washy?
No chisley-wizzly.
All right. I'll takey-takey it. Let's see. What have I bought so far?
A crib, a velocipede, alphabet block, Indian suit, an electric train, and a Buck Rogers disintegrator gun.
Well, I guess that's enough for my kids.
Oh, you must be a proud father. You know, I have 8 children of my own.
Hey, you don't sound like it. As many as that? Well, Oh, by the way, if I don't like my kid, will you take back these toys?
If you don't like your child?
Yes. If I don't like them, I'll send them back.
You can do that?
Why, certainly.
Why don't somebody tell me these things?
Will you kindly get back in line? But look, I'm expecting a baby today. I mean, an orphan. He's arriving on this boat.
These other folks are here for the same purpose. Just wait until I call the name of your kid and then yell.
Oh, okay. See, I'm excited.
Louis Carbone, Pierre Renoir, Cecile Degas, Marcel Bender. Nice going, brother. All right, take your orphan.
But which one is it? I mean, which is Marcel Bender?
I am Marcel Bender.
Oh, my little baby.
I mean, oh, baby. Look, there must be some mistake. You can't be Marcel. I really expected a baby.
But I am Marcel.
My goodness, how long did that trip take?
Something wrong? You do not feel well?
Oh, no, no. I feel fine. Just fine.
But, monsieur, you are trembling.
Well, it's just that I had a different picture of how you would look. The construction, you know. I thought you'd be a little younger.
But I am young. I'm only 19.
No, but I expected a little itty-kitty-witty. You're a beautiful, gorgeous young girl. They can't do that to me. Or can they?
Hello?
Oh, nothing. What about me, Marcel? Do I look the way you expected me to look?
Oh, no, monsieur. I thought you would be an old man with a beard.
An old man with a beard. Fooled you that time, huh?
Yes, you have no beard at all. I'm glad you like me. I was so afraid you'd be ashamed of me in this poor little dress I wear.
The dress?
Yes, it is all I have and very small for me. Look, see how tight it fits me.
Uh-huh.
And the dress is very short, too, because I've worn it many years. See, it is above my knees.
Uh-huh.
But you're only looking at my feet.
Don't rush me.
Oh, no, monsieur. But if I am to leave at your home, I cannot call you monsieur. What shall I call you?
Well, let's see. Would you mind holding my pulse for a minute?
Like these?
That's right. Now call me Daddy.
Daddy?
What about the pulse?
Oh, she jumped up and down very fast.
She does. Well, then call me Uncle Jim.
Uncle Jim.
The pulse?
Oh, she jumps very quick.
She does, eh? And you better call me Mr. Sloan, I think, huh?
Mr. Sloan?
Yes, until we get home. Then I'll take a vitamin pill and you can try Daddy again. Let's go.
I beg pardon, Mr. Sloan.
What is it, Charles?
I wanted on the telephone, Miss Clara Palmer.
Oh, Clara. Well. Hello? Oh, hello, Clara. Well, I've been busy the last 2 weeks. Tonight? Oh, I can't. Why, I'm taking Marcel to the matzo ball. You know, Herbert J. Matzo. What? I had a date to take you? Oh, I'm sorry, but I'll see you there anywhere. Anyway, I want you to meet Marcel. Goodbye, Clara.
Oh, Uncle Jim, are you busy?
No. Come in, Marcel.
Oh, Uncle Jim, I'm so happy here. Your house is lovely, and the big rooms, and the beautiful paintings on the walls.
Well, I'm glad you're happy. Marcel, you know I'm in the plumbing fixture business, don't you?
Yes, Uncle Jim, you told me.
Well, I have a big surprise for you. I sat up all night, all last night, designing a new bathtub just for you.
For me?
Uh-huh. It's going to be built in the shape of a kangaroo. And then when you take a bath, you sit in the pouch. Oh, it's a knockout.
Charming. Oh, Uncle Jim, you haven't said anything about my new dress.
Well.
Do you like it, or does it leave too much of me outside?
No. It's beautiful, Marcel.
Oh, how happy that makes me. I want so much to please you at the ball tonight. Oh, I bought some other things, too, Uncle Jean. The perfume I'm wearing, these gloves, and a beautiful pair of garters. Would you like to see them?
Garters? No, Marcel. You mustn't bother.
Oh, but they are lovely. Please let me show you my garters.
No. You mustn't bother.
But there is no bother. They are in my room in a little package.
Oh. Then you certainly mustn't bother.
I found it in a little French lingerie shop, the Maison Claudette. And wouldn't believe it, Madame Claudette is a fifth cousin by marriage of the nephew of the wife of my fourth cousin, Anatole.
Well, one divorce in the family, you'll have to arrange that all over again. Come on, Marcel, we mustn't be late for the dance. Clara, this is my orphan, Marcel Bender. Marcel, this is Clara Palmer.
How do you do?
One arm.
You silly boy.
Well, I'll be back, Marcel.
Oh, my, Jim is so charming, isn't he? Such a gentleman.
Yes, and he seems so good to me.
He probably hasn't told you that this whole thing is a hideous mistake.
I don't understand.
Well, you know, he wanted a little boy. You were quite a shock to him. Of course, he doesn't want to hurt you.
Miss Palmer.
Yes?
Please, you have said enough. I understand now, and I will go away.
Oh, are you going without saying goodbye to Jim?
Yes, I will leave now.
Now, pull yourself together, Charles. What did she do? What did she say?
Well, she took her bag, sir, and said goodbye, sir. To be exact, sir, she said goodbye, Charles, sir.
Never mind, sir. I mean, never mind. This is terrible. I've got to find her.
I beg your pardon, sir, but are you in love with the young lady, sir?
In love?
Yes, sir.
Certainly not. I just happen to like orphans. Gee, I read Orphan Annie all the time. Anyway, I'm a lot older than Marcel.
Very good, sir.
It is not. I can't understand it, Charles. I simply can't understand why she left. Gee, maybe she didn't like me. Oh, that's impossible. Isn't it, Charles? Isn't it, Charles?
Night, sir.
You coward.
And so the curtain falls on the first act of our show tonight, Parent by Proxy. Follow the adventures of socialite Jim, alias Jack Benny Sloan. But right now, here's our own man about the microphone, Bud Heaston. Brett? And now the second act of Parent by Proxy, starring Jack Benny and Paulette Goddard, and adapted for us by Keith Fowler, Frank Galen, and Sam Perrin, from an original by Charles B.N., Kalia Young, and John McClain.
I haven't got that many riders.
Now, it's the following evening, and Jim Sloan is returning from a fruitless all-day search for his ward, Marcel.
Oh, good evening, sir. Any news, sir?
No, Charles. I spent the entire day walking the streets of New York, didn't even get a glimpse of her. Just think of it, Charles. A beautiful little French girl of 19, all alone in this big city. Who will look after her? I mean, who will try to be her friend?
I beg pardon, sir, but are you kidding, sir?
Look, Charles, I've got to find her. Now, let's see. Where would I go if I were a gorgeous young French girl? Where wouldn't I go?
Well, sir, you might be in one of the better cafes, the Stock Club or El Morocco.
No, they're too expensive for a young French girl like me. No, they're not either. The man who takes me would naturally pay the check. I keep forgetting I'm beautiful.
Yes, sir, it's quite easy, sir.
Oh, I don't know. With a close shave and the right sweater? No, but this isn't getting us anywhere. Where would I go if I were a French refugee in the... Wait. The Maison Claudette. It's a lingerie shop. I gotta get right over there.
Oh, sir, aren't you taking this game about being a girl too seriously?
The lingerie isn't for me. I'm gonna try and find Marcel in it. I mean, well, you know what I mean, Charles. Pardon me. Are you Madame Claudette?
Yes, monsieur. Can I help you?
I hope so. You see, I'm interested in a girl. And I thought...
That... I understand, monsieur.
Do you think you can help me?
I will try, monsieur. Now, if the young lady prefers panties of black lace, these are...
Yes! Panties?
Monsieur does not like them?
Oh, yes, of course. It was just the shock of seeing them.
What
know?
Did you expect to see in a lingerie shop? Bicycles?
No, you don't understand. I came in here for something else entirely.
Indeed, monsieur. Unfortunately, I happen to be a very busy woman. Perhaps my clerk will be able to help you. I'll send her right out.
But, Madame Claudette, all I... Say, these are kind of cute at that. Black lace. And so soft and fluffy. I wonder if... No, they probably only make them for women. Gee, black lace...
Jeez.
Panties! I mean, Marcel!
Mrs. Sloan, how did you know I was here?
Never mind that. Imagine going away without leaving a note. That isn't nice, you know. Why, once when I suddenly went away, I left a note for the milkman. And I don't even like him.
Oh, please, Mr. Sloan. Miss Pomeroy has explained everything to me. I cannot leave at her home anymore.
Miss Pomeroy? So that's it. Look, Marcel, I want you to come back. Please, won't you come back?
Well, all right.
Come on, dear. Oh, by the way, Marcel, before we leave, what's the biggest size in those black lace... Oh, never mind. Hello, Charles. Look what I've got.
Why, you found her, sir. Welcome home, Miss Bender.
Thank you, Charles.
Oh, I beg pardon, sir, but the refugee committee is waiting to see you in the drawing room.
To see me? You wait right here, Marcel.
All right.
Now, good evening, gentlemen. Did you want to see me?
Yes, Mr. Sloan. We're from the refugee committee. It has come to our attention that you, a single man, have accepted as your ward a 19-year-old girl. We cannot permit it.
Now, wait a minute. I'm only one of thousands who offer a helping hand to refugees. Someone gets a freckle-faced boy, someone gets a pug-nosed kid, someone else gets a little girl in pigtails. Can I help it if I hit the jackpot?
I'm sorry, Mr. Sloan.
All right, give her to someone else. I only did what any generous man would have done. I pitied that poor homeless refugee. I felt sorry for her. I didn't feel
I
that
I... I want you to pity me, Mr. Sloan.
Marcel, you shouldn't have listened. I mean, I didn't mean that.
I know what you meant. I want to go away again.
Look, was your mother frightened by a commutation ticket?
Miss Bender, we've arranged for you to be taken to another home, Mrs. Hortense Van Martin's.
Marcel, you don't want to stay with Mrs. Van Martin. She's an eccentric old... she's an old eccentric.
I will pack my things.
But Marcel... That's the thanks I get for being a nice guy. I wanted a boy in the first place. I'd have been better off that way.
We can still get you a boy.
Why these things happen to me, I don't know. All the trouble I went through with that girl.
We can still get you a boy.
Boy would have been much simpler, believe me.
We can still get you a boy.
Oh, stop mumbling. For heaven's sake. Hortense, Marcel will be here any minute. I came over to tell you I think the poor little thing will be better off in your care.
James, what do you mean, poor little thing?
Excuse me a moment. All right, boys, you can bring him in.
Where do you want the sandbox, Bud?
Anywhere will do. And put the kitty car over there.
James, what is the meaning of this?
Marcel's toys. I thought you might as well have them.
Toys? I thought she was a grown girl.
Oh, she is. Physically. I'll set up her choo-choo train before she gets there.
James, do you mean...
No. Don't forget, when she runs the train, you stand right here and go beep, beep.
Beep, beep.
Yes, you see, you're supposed to be a station wagon at the railroad crossing. It's not hard. As a matter of fact, in that dress, you look a little like a station wagon.
James, I thought she was a perfectly normal girl.
Well, she's practically normal, Hortense. Look. This is her little Indian suit. You see, sometimes she thinks she's Pocahontas.
Oh.
And if you want to keep her quiet, just give her a telephone directory. She loves to call all the John Smiths in it, you know?
I don't feel well, James. I need rest and quiet.
Oh, and here's her little bow and arrow.
Bow and arrow?
Oh, she's quite harmless, but don't ever eat an apple in front of her.
I think I'd better lie down. I'm ill.
Mrs. Van Martin, the young lady has arrived.
Oh, ask her to come in. You just run along, Hortense. I'll take care of everything.
Thank you, James. You're a very sympathetic boy, even if you are a plumber.
Oh, think nothing of it. All right, Hawkins.
Yes, sir. Right this way, miss.
What are you doing here?
Oh, just making sure you'd be comfortable, Marcel. Mrs. Van Martin's upstairs whipping the maid. She'll be right down.
She's whipping the maid?
Oh, it won't take a minute. Only 30 lashes.
What did the maid do?
She put noodles in the chicken soup.
But there's nothing wrong with that.
I know, but don't ever say that in front of Mrs. Van Martin. Why, she'd probably jump right off the shelf. You know?
What shelf?
The shelf she sits on when she thinks she's a teapot.
She sounds crazy.
Oh, she's not so bad now, Marcel. Why, when she cooks a roast beef, she doesn't even crawl into the oven to watch it anymore. You know?
I don't want to stay here. I wish I'd never come here, and I wish I'd never seen you.
But, Marcel...
Go away. You never wanted me, and now I'm trying to forget your face.
You can't, Marcel. It's on half the bathtubs in this country.
Please go away. You only took me in out of pity.
No, I didn't.
I heard you say it yourself.
I only said that so these men wouldn't take you away. I didn't want you to go.
But I do not understand. What are you trying to tell me?
Look, Marcel, it's as simple as ABC on these blocks. I'll show you. We'll start with the letter I. Here's an I. No, it's a J. Well, here's an I. No, that's an L. Well, this must be an I. A K. Must be an easier way to do this.
Here's an I.
Oh, yes, thanks. I stands for I.
Yes.
Now, where's that L we just had? Oh, here. Do you know what the L stands for?
Love.
Look, I'm trying to be cute about this thing. Would you be so direct? Well, shall I go on?
No, you don't have to.
Good.
Ben, what are you doing?
Throwing away these blocks. From now on, we're going to play house.
Thank you, Jack Benny and Paulette Goddard, for a swell show and a grand cause. And thanks to Oscar Bradley for his excellent score. You know, ladies and gentlemen, this is the star's own theater. And the money they would ordinarily receive, Gulf gives instead to the Motion Picture Relief Fund. So, Jack, thanks again to both you and Paulette Goddard. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to tell you about next week's show. Next week, your Gulf Screen Guild Theater presents four great stars, Greer Garson, Henry Fonda, Fred McMurray, and Virginia Widler, in the first radio presentation of one of the year's greatest box office smashes, The Philadelphia Story. Here's a show I know you won't want to miss, so note it on your calendar. Until next Sunday, then, this is Roger Pryor speaking for your neighborhood good golf dealer and saying, good night, everyone.
Top of the morning to you. This is Arthur Anderson. But let's pretend I'm Lucky the Leprechaun. You're listening to the Glowing Dial here in Yesterday, USA. Oh, you like the Glowing Dial. For us, said Arthur Anderson, it's magically nostalgic. That doesn't quite scan, does it? But you know what I mean.
Yes, we know what you mean. Thank you, Arthur.
A lot of magic in this show here. We got Mandrake with his magic, and we got the magic of Lucky Charms.
They're magically delicious. It's in the wee hours of the morning right now, folks, and time to close this thing out. But Steve, quickly go over our contact methods, if you would, please.
Contact. Yes, you can contact us by phone.
Mm-hmm.
My number is area code 810-774-0112.
And the snail mail address is?
1855. Right?
No.
What is your snail mail?
He has to learn that yet. Snail mail address, folks, is 1055.
1055.
Townhouse Lane, Traverse City, Michigan.
49684?
49686. Don't confuse the listeners until you know what you're doing.
I still haven't learned it yet.
Oh, dude.
Have to stay after school.
An email, which is slightly malfunctioning right now, but it's glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at voyager.net.
That one I know.
If it keeps giving problems, we may be switching.
I'd rather fight than switch.
What is working pretty much right now is the website, www.glowingdial.com. So head on over there, surf on over there, and let us know you were there, and tell us what you think of the website.
The Jack website, right.
Not quite. Anyway, visit Glowdial's bookstore in association with Amazon.com, and just so much good stuff there to see and enjoy. And if you have any suggestions on the page, how we can make it any better, please don't hesitate to get in contact with us and let us know.
Yes, we love to hear from you. Really, we do.
Mm-hmm.
You're our biggest fans.
Yes. So, anyway, that's going to just about do it for us here on the Glowing Dial.
It's time to say goodbye already.
Yeah, it is.
I hate to say goodbye. But I guess we must.
Mm-hmm.
I must be brave. And face this. I will be brave.
Yes, face it, face it, face it.
Let's face it.
That's right. And our music fading in and out here is the Stumbling Foxtrot by Paul Whiteman and his orchestra from 1922.
That's right. 1922. There we go.
Yeah, well, it was there. We just weren't hearing it. This wonderful setup, if you could see this. Actually, you will see it on the webpage once we post some of the pictures. But that's going to do it for this edition of The Glowing Dial. Tune in next time, folks. And until then, keep a positive thought. Keep looking up. And we'll see you on the radio. Bye-bye.
Yesterday USA Superstation.